They say that every great story begins with a failure. So let me share with you a personal failure. Before I started my service, the Air Force had asked me and invited me to take part in tests of fighter pilot course. At the test, they gave me a device with many parts that I had to assemble. And when I finished and came back with the device and asked, what do I do with all the parts that left? As you know, I did not pass this test. But you know how this story ended. Because the Air Force, rightly so, would not take me as a pilot, but 30 years later, it accepted me as their Supreme Commander. And to be honest, when I disembarked an F-16 aircraft, as the Chief of Staff, seeing the pilot in action, I understood and totally agreed that the Air Force actually knew exactly what they are doing with those recruitment procedures of them. Tonight I would like, given the short time, I would like to speak with you about some experiences and personal stories from my tenure as Israel Defense Forces Chief of Staff. I would like to share with you some thoughts on the security challenges Israel, and it is fair to say the world, is facing and will face in the future. And just to emphasize the dynamics we have in the Middle East, I will describe how my farewell meeting at the Knesset looked like. That day, I arrived at the Knesset, and among the very few politicians that actually showed up was Shaul Mofaz, Israel's former Chief of Staff and a Minister of Defense. He told me, Benny, you are very lucky because you had only one Prime Minister to work with and two Minister of Defense. And we were laughing about the nature of Israeli politicians. And I told him, you know, Shaul, it is true that I had to work with one Prime Minister, but I had to deal with three Egyptian presidents. So tell me, who's the lucky one? So yes, the one thing that mostly characterized the Middle East today, and I guess that will be the case for the next few years, it is instability. Let's delve into some of those challenges that we are talking about. I will start in the northern Israeli border, with the situation in Syria always evolving and escalating. Recently, Israel admitted that 10 years ago our Air Force attacked and destroyed a Syrian nuclear facility that was built by the assistance of North Korean engineers. 2 months ago, 4 Israeli Air Force F-16 aircraft set out to Syria to retaliate and attack an Iranian outpost that launched a UAV into Israel. A week ago, it was published but not confirmed by Israel, the Russian accused Israel for attacking facility in Syria, killing 4 Iranians. And today, the entire world is waiting to see if President Trump will attack in Syria and respond to Assad's awful chemical attack. As you just heard, many players are involved in Syria, in the Syrian crisis, Russia, US, Hezbollah, Turkey, and others, and unfortunately, I do not see any solution in the near future. And Syria is in a different situation than it used to be 10 years ago, with 7 years of ongoing crisis and no end in sight. The state collapsed. Some will say the state is not a state anymore. I believe Israel should not be involved in the situation in Syria as long as it does not interfere with our security and the safety of our people. Unfortunately, in the meantime, we will continue to see horrifying acts of cruelty and hatred. I believe we will all agree that the pictures of Syrians gassed by their own government is indeed a proof and a showcase of an act of brutal and cruelty. today was the Holocaust Memorial Day in Israel. As a son of a Holocaust survivor and a member of the Jewish tribe, I could not stand aside, and I can share with you today that one of the things that I'm most proud of for my service as the Chief of Staff is operating an IDF field hospital in our northern border. More than 4,000 Syrian victims were treated by Israeli soldiers and doctors. And even today, as we speak, our northern hospital's trauma departments have many Syrian patients being treated by our doctors and nurses. Think what kind of a message we deliver to the world by doing such a thing. It is as if we are telling them it is true that we are the strongest country in the Middle East, but we are also right, and we will never change, and we will remain true to our values. We will stand by our principles. We are the men and women of the IDF, the strongest military force in the region, and the most moral military in the world, even when facing our enemies. And very close to this field hospital that symbolizes compassion and humanity lies the biggest threat to Israel today, Lebanon and its increasing capabilities at the hands of Hezbollah. I've served in Lebanon for many years. I even received my major rank on the hill in Lebanon in the middle of the war. In Lebanon, I've learned from my own experience that houses inhabited by women and children also had a bunker inhabited by bombs and rockets. Indeed, Hezbollah is the main threat from Lebanon. In 2006, they had 12,000 rockets. In 2012, 40,000 rockets. And today, and I want you to listen to those numbers very carefully, they have more than 100,000 rockets in their possessions. So like you know by now, most of the houses in Lebanon have a living room and a rocket room in the same house. This method of using women and children as viewing shield will bring them nothing but devastating results. We should definitely be on alert. The next war might not be easy, but let me assure you, there is no doubt that we will defeat them like we will defeat whoever acts against the State of Israel. And of course, I must share with you my thoughts about Gaza, about Gaza Strip, and the Palestinian Authority. The past 2 weeks taught us that this challenge is not going anyway. Hamas is trying to find unique ways to use civilian population as human shield. As Gazans assembled thousands of tires and burned them during Friday protest, marching toward Israel's border and burned tires aimed to create smoke screen, shielding protesters and enabling terrorists to damage the border infrastructure and to set explosive device along it. The outcome of this action only hurt the Gazan people. People are being injured and killed because we must defend our sovereignty and security. This burning of tires burned down Palestinian fields near the border, and heavy smoke toxins the population and caused a huge environmental disaster for them. Hamas is doing everything in its capability to rearm, to build offensive tunnels, and achieve other operational capabilities. As the Chief of Staff, I commanded 3 campaigns in Gaza and the West Bank, and I saw how Hamas is using civilian human shields. And just like in Lebanon, many houses in Gaza have a cellar, and it is for rockets and not for wine. The last operation in Gaza occurred more than 3 years ago. Protective Edge started after 3 Jewish kids were kidnapped and murdered by terrorists. The operation caught me on Friday before heading to my office in Tel Aviv when I left my home for a morning run on the beach. And the next time I came home was 75 days later. Our fighters fought with courage and defeated Hamas in every engagement. The operation has achieved all its goals and gave the citizens of the South the longest ever period of calm from Gaza. Israel is very strong, and we have solutions like Iron Dome, new technologies for tunnels, and many more ways to handle these threats. Nevertheless, and assuming that we don't want to conquer Gaza again, we probably need to fight back every few years. But I want to take you back to Protective Edge Operation. Regretfully, we lost 68 of our best sons, and we still need to bring back home two of our soldiers that were killed and that their bodies are still captured by Hamas, Oron Shaul and Adar Golden. I would like to share with you the story of Hadar Goldin. Today I can honestly say that it was one of the hardest moments I had as a chief of staff. The incident happened on August 1st at 8 a.m. after we declared and agreed on a ceasefire that Hamas has broken just a few hours later. I was at the war room with my commanders and the Minister of Defense, and receive a message that terrorists attack one of our combat units from a tunnel, killing three of our soldiers and kidnapping Hadar Goldin inside the tunnel. Moments later, I got a message that Hadar Goldin's twin brother, Tzur, also a combat soldier, is inside Gaza, still fighting. Now, I want you to think how a mother feels when two of her sons are fighting a war and their lives are in constant danger. Thinking of that, I could not take any risk of having Tzur in danger after I knew his brother was killed and his body is missing. I ordered to stop all activities immediately, to find Tzur and take him out of Gaza. And only after I knew Tzur is out of Gaza and in a safe place and next to a phone, I allowed our team to deliver the terrible message about Hadar's death and kidnapping to his parents. And as I mentioned, we still need to bring Hadar Shaul, and all the other sons back home. But I also would like to speak about the heroism of our soldiers. Israel will soon mark 70 years of its establishment. Each and every one of our military accomplishments in those 70 years was achieved by the bravery of our soldiers. In the same operation, Eitan Font served as a deputy commander in the elite unit of the Givati Brigade. After Hadar Goldin was kidnapped by Hamas, Eitan decided to go into the tunnel and try saving him. Since the tunnel was very, very narrow, he made a decision and took off all his physical protection, all the physical protection he had, his helmet, his ceramic vest, his special weapons. He went inside the tunnel, equipped with nothing but courage and values, serving him as an invisible defensive shield, knowing he's putting his life in danger to save a fellow soldier. Unfortunately, Hadar was already dead, but because of Eitan's action, we had an evidence providing Hamas did not have a live soldier in their hands. When the fighting was over, I decided to award Eitan with a personal decoration medal for his distinguished service and for his act of bravery that inspires us all. And we cannot ignore the constant factor influencing and shaping all other challenges, the Palestinian Authority. Our number one interest is to find a solution. This is not just a political question of left or right. And as we all know, whenever there are Jews, there are 5 opinions, 4 strategic plans, and 3 synagogues. During my service, I met an Arab leader in one of the countries in the Middle East, and he told me, General Gantz, there are 14 million people between the Jordan and the ocean. A few millions are Jews, few are Palestinians, and no one is going anywhere. We need to find ways to live together. And I could not agree more. So I'm telling you that I believe it is for us, as Israelis, it is important for us to find a solution without compromising our security needs and the safety of our people. I cannot predict what happened in our region in a year, in a month, or even next week. 2 things are certain. There will always be uncertainty, and we will always have to be ready. Challenges will always be part of our lives, and we don't have the luxury to not be prepared. Thankfully, we are not alone in this fight. There is no doubt that when speaking on Israel's allies, the Jewish community in Mexico is an ally. You are an ally, and caring for each other has become our strength and tradition. And sometimes not only for each other as Jews, but using Jewish values of Tikkun Olam, repair the world, and helps others. What you see here is Israeli doctors that came to operate kids in Mexico. Or you see 71 soldiers and officers from the IDF that came here 6 months ago to assist the Mexican authorities after the earthquake and try to save people's life. This should all make us proud and understand that our countries and communities have special and strength and tradition and very important strategic relations. The partnership between us, the Jewish communities, is hard to describe in words. It comes from the heart and with the understanding that together we are stronger. I have a special connection to Tel Aviv University. I am an alumni of Tel Aviv University. My wife, who is with us tonight, is also a student in the University of Tel Aviv, working for her PhD. And believe it or not, our son is also a student in Tel Aviv University. I believe that education should be Israel's number one national priority. I'm familiar with the great programs that you are supporting and your scholarship fund, and I'm so proud to stand here today to be able to say thank you for what you are doing. What you are doing as a community is not less important than what I did. The safety of our state is not only depend on strong military capabilities, it must also have a strong society. And I want to thank you for your devotion, because together we have a stronger society. Israel will benefit from this contribution for many years, and I like to call it a Zionist partnership. Let me take you back to Bergen-Belsen, Germany in 1945. A 17-year-old girl, all skin and bones at 28 kilos, have survived the Nazis' hell. She wanders from Germany to Sweden, from them to Italy, expelled to Cyprus, and finally arrived to Israel, home at last. That girl was my mother. She used to always tell me that for her, Israel will always be the home of Jewish people. When I became a general, she asked me to make sure that Israel stays strong so that all Jews will know they have a home, they have a home. And right after she finished giving me this Zionist speech, she told me, "General," and I said, "What?" And she said, "Take out the garbage." Yeah, she was something. And I wanted you to take a look at this picture. This is my mother when she stepped out from the camp. And I want you to look at the next picture. This is me as Israel Chief of Staff, and that soldier is our son. I'm giving him his paratrooper red beret after he successfully finished his training as a paratrooper. And I'm proud to say today, we, the Jewish people, won. But this is the path of the Jewish people, that the Jewish people go through since the dawn of history. Every place and every memory symbolizes both a great struggle and a great joy, hardship and blessing. Yes, my friend, you will always have a home in Israel, and we will always have you standing with us. I would like to conclude by saying thank you for your ongoing support and partnership. We do not take it for granted. Let us all remember, it is our country, it is our mutual challenges, and it is our future that we are building together. Thank you very much.